My name is Vic Chib, and I'm an assistant professor in the BME department. And in my lab, we study decision making and neuroeconomics. So how rewards and incentives, such as money or social situations like this, influence performance and get you to perform well in certain situations and maybe not so well in other situations. And in my lab, we use a combination of techniques. We use neuroimaging, which we're going to talk about today. So we put people in the fMRI scanner, the MRI scanner, and we look at how their brain lights up when they're doing different tasks and how it responds to incentive. We model the neural activity and behaviors to sort of figure out the mechanisms that underlie performance. We also use non-invasive brain stimulation, which we won't talk about, just behavioral experiments in general in human subjects. Okay, so today what I'm going to tell you about is just a brief overview of fMRI. So, you know, a lot of times you guys probably read stories in the New York Times and people say this area lights up when you do this activity. And so that my goal or my hope is that today you'll have an idea, you'll get an idea of how people do those studies. Maybe you won't become experts in fMRI studies. If you want to become an expert, see me afterwards and maybe you can work in the lab. But you could just get an idea of how to sort of critically assess some of the things that you read in the news about what your brain is doing, okay? So today we're going to go over just basics of neuroimaging and some basics of interpreting MRI studies. And then next class I'll tell you a little bit about the work from my lab where we use these techniques, okay? Does anybody have any questions before we get started? No, okay. So the general idea in fMRI is you put people in a big magnet, so like this, and out come images like this, where you have a brain, sort of a structural image of the brain, and then some colored blobs in certain regions of the brain that people like to associate with some neural activity and correlated behavior. Okay, so we're going to talk about how you go from putting somebody in a scanner like this to getting activations in your brain like that. Okay, so there are three main components to MRI, and those are basically a really big magnet. So when you put somebody in this cylinder, there's a really large magnet. There's a radio transmitter and a radio receiver. So the transmitter, then you put somebody, the general idea is you put somebody in a magnet, molecules in their body align to the direction of that magnetic field. The radio transmitter emits a pulse, a radio pulse, that excites those molecules in a certain way, and they in turn send off some radio signal that is received by the receiver, and that's sort of where your images come from. So, and we'll unpack that a little bit more now. So, first thing you start off with is a static magnetic field. So, in an MRI scanner, you're sitting in a field that is about 2 Teslas, or between 2 and 7 Teslas. There's up to 9 Tesla magnets. So, here at Hopkins, we have two 3 Tesla magnets and a 7 Tesla magnet. Okay, to give you an idea, the Earth's magnetic field is 31 microteslas, so really small. And a refrigerator magnet is 5 milliteslas, okay? So this is a huge magnetic field compared to what we get from the Earth, okay? And so basically the idea is that the nuclei of some atoms behave like small magnets and they align with the external magnetic field. So you put people in the magnetic field, and some atoms in your body will align to that magnetic field. You excite these molecules with a radio wave, like basically a radio frequency pulse of the right frequency, and they'll then flip direction, and over time they'll start to relax back to the direction of that magnetic field. And that relaxation, so different atoms have different relaxation times, and those different relaxation times allow us to image different the activity of different molecules or the behavior of different molecules, okay? And that's basically the principle of nuclear magnetic resonance. And as I said before, the strength of that relaxation depends on the chemical composition of the tissue, okay? So basically the idea is that you've got some atomic nuclei that spin around an axis, and they're in their, when you're in the wild, they're just sort of spinning as they usually do. And they basically they behave like really small magnets that have a north and south pole, okay, like the Earth. And without the magnetic field, the spins orient randomly. So you see like this. You insert a magnetic field, or you put somebody in the magnetic field. You put these molecules in, or and atoms in a magnetic field, and they'll begin to align. And you'll see that the majority are slightly more aligned. The majority of them are aligned to the field more, and then some might be slightly disaligned, so in the opposite direction. But on a whole, the majority sort of align with that magnetic field. Then what you can do is you can introduce a radio frequency pulse and basically perturb the alignment of these molecules away from that magnetic field, and that's called precession, basically. So, and that's the source of the MRI signal. So, similar to a spinning top, spins precess about the applied magnetic field. So, here you see the magnetic field. This atom is sort of spinning about that magnetic field. The precession causes the magnetic field to transverse the z-axis, so you're sort of moving about the z-axis, if you think the magnetic field is along the z. And the changing field is the same thing as a radio wave, which is picked up by the radio receiver. So the way that this atom sort of relaxes back is what's picked up by the receiver. And so the radio transmitter and the scanner sends out a radio wave pulse at a specific frequency that matches the precession frequency. And it depends, these pulses are going to be different depending on what you want to image. So depending on the kind of molecules that you're imaging, you'll give a different radio frequency pulse. When you're doing MRI, you're imaging oxygenation of blood. So there's a sequence specific for imaging that. The pulse causes spins to tilt towards the XY plane. Over time, they flip back or relax, emitting a radio signal. And by varying the scanner's magnetic field with those pulses, yeah.
I was just wondering, you said it matches the precession frequency of what you're turning, but the previous slide you said that the precession was relaxing, which was causing electromagnetic waves.
So. Right. So what you're doing is you're in the magnetic field. You know that there's a radio frequency pulse that will excite the atom and cause it to sort of be perturbed off of that magnet, off of the axis of the magnetic field. And then you wait until your next pulse. And in that time that you're waiting, it relaxes back and basically gives off a radio frequency.
Okay. So that means that at the time you're exciting it, it's not actually.
That's yeah. I'm sorry. Yes, you're right.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I apologize. Yeah, you're right.
Matching the precession frequency means it's matching the precession frequency that's caused.
Yes. Yeah. I'm sorry for the confusion. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So, right. And so basically, what you see here is that this idea of precession or coming back to that axis. So you see the XY plane, and like I said before, you're sort of excited off, you sort of relax back over time, and you can see that there's a decay in the XY plane and then sort of a recovery along the Z plane. Okay, and that's that precession. And so by varying the magnetic field along the Z axis, along that gradient coil, only tissues in a particular Z location get excited and emit a signal. So basically what you can do is you can then give some excitation pulses where the brain is, where their head is, and look at how that influences the precession of atoms in that volume, okay? And so the general idea behind, or the physiology behind fMRI is that when there is some synaptic firing. So you see a synapse here. It releases glutamate, and that signals blood to flow to give energy to the neural firing that's happening. So that blood flow is actually what you're imaging. You're not actually imaging spiking of neurons, so the electrical signals associated with neurons. You're imaging the blood flow that's associated with increased metabolism required by those neurons. Okay, does that make sense? And that's called BOLD, so blood oxygen level dependent signal. So the origins of the BOLD signal, synaptic transmission releases glutamate. Glutamate then causes blood flow to increase, and this causes the concentration of deoxygenated hemoglobin to decrease where the blood flow increases. Because deoxygenated hemoglobin reduces the MRI signal, a decrease in deoxyhemoglobin increases MRI signal, and thus increased neural activity leads to an increase in MRI signal. Okay, so increased synaptic transmission results in increased blood flow, and that's what you're imaging in MRI. So go ahead.
Why does deoxyhemoglobin reduce the MRI signal?
Because basically what it's doing is it's reducing the amount of, you're reducing the amount of oxygen in the blood, and so what you're imaging is the amount of oxygen that is in the blood, and that's the signal that you're picking up. So wait, so what?
There's less oxygen in the blood, there's less signal.
This causes a concentration. You're reducing the amount of deoxygenated hemoglobin. Okay, so basically the hemoglobin becomes more oxygenated, that, and there's more blood as well, and that causes an increased signal. Okay. So basically the idea is that you guys have probably seen that what a lot of people study here is firing of neurons, right? So the spikes that you see. So here we're not able to, with fMRI, we're not able to look at what exactly is happening with spikes. We're looking at what's happening with blood flow and trying to say something about spikes from that blood flow, okay? So there's a bit of a stretch, right? So basically with fMRI, what you're doing is you're acquiring an image of the entire brain in about 1 to 4 seconds. So you don't have the same temporal resolution that you do with imaging neuronal firing. But it offers really good spatial resolution. So you're able to look at the whole brain and millimeter resolution throughout the whole brain, okay? So basically the idea is that neural activity increases local blood flow, which causes an increase in MRI signal. All right. And so the way this looks is, so if you see here, time on the x-axis, HRF, so basically the BOLD signal on the y-axis, so blood oxygenation. If you see an event at time zero, so stimulus goes on, neurons will begin to fire shortly after, and your BOLD signal though looks like this. So it's delayed by about 8 seconds. So it happens about 8 seconds after the stimulus occurs, right? So that's a bit of a problem, right? You're not the signal that you're getting is not happening exactly at the time that the event occurs. So there's some tricks that we do to try and sort of push back the signal to understand how it happens relative to onsets. But you can think that this makes it not very good method to image very precisely timed events that you want to study, right? So if you want to study something like scene processing, for example, or language, where things happen at very precise points in time and dynamically very quickly in time, you don't really get a good idea of what brain activity is happening with this method. Okay? Right, and so we talked about peak BOLD response. Okay, so Because BOLD is based on blood flow, the temporal resolution is limited by the precision of blood flow regulation, so a few hundred milliseconds. The spatial resolution is limited by the strength of the signal, so 1 millimeter is what you generally get, resolution is what you get for a 3T magnet. And the thing to realize is there are hundreds of thousands of neurons in each one of those voxels. So you're not able to really say what's happening in specific neurons, but over a large pool of neurons, okay? And you can't measure absolute amounts of activity or metabolism with BOLD. You only measure differences between, you can only measure differences between conditions, okay? So the logic behind fMRI experiments then is to present some stimuli and then look at differences between two conditions to sort of see if there's increased or decreased activity with respect to control conditions, okay? So you're measuring a BOLD signal to find a region showing increased activity to a stimulus or task as compared to a control, okay? Yeah.
Are you going to measure this fMRI signal while the subject is performing some sort of task?
Yeah, so the field is you're always in the field. So the magnetic field is always on when you're an MRI scanner. The thing that's changing is the RF signal, okay? So with those perturbations that we talked about, that's what's changing and that precession that we talked about before is what you're measuring. So you put somebody in an MRI scanner, you send a radio frequency pulse, it excites or perturbs an atom, then we look at how that atom relaxes, and that sends off a radio frequency signal that we're measuring. So
but if they're performing a task and then moving about.
So if they're performing a task and they're moving around, that can change the magnetic field. So what you're doing is, what you do when you're doing these tasks is you want people to be really still. So they're very still, and generally they're doing things where they're pressing buttons. Yeah, so you can't do things where you have a bunch of movement in the MRI scanner, okay? And we do some things where we have people make movements in the scanner, but we have to then control for the movements that they're making. So it's actually a lot more challenging if you're trying to get people to move a lot. So that is another limitation of it.